Good morning. It's my pleasure to welcome each of you this morning. It's a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. On a beautiful day like this, spring day, what a great, it makes you just feel good, feel happy, especially when you're in the house of the Lord. This week I was, after I was finished working one evening, the sun had gone down and I was sitting in our gazebo for a bit, and the birds were singing and you could hear them just dying down, that their songs were dying down and they were getting ready for the night. And I was thinking how wonderful it is for rest, that we can all have rest. The birds went to their night for rest, and we as human beings go to rest. And then I thought about our Sabbath that we have and how we have a rest from the week, and in our night's sleep we get refreshed in the morning. And that's the way Sunday is. We are refreshed as we come together and worship. How wonderful it is. I have a few announcements this morning. First of all, if anybody finds any car keys, there were some that were lost yesterday at the wedding, and just turn them in if you find them. And there's an announcement about the spring fling in your bulletins, and if anybody, which is Tuesday night for the women, and if anybody wants to, that hasn't registered, just call Holly, and she'll help you out with that. And remember, the offering basket is in the back. If you have an offering that you'd like to drop in that, be sure to do that. Jeff and Janet are on vacation in New York this weekend, and Jim is away at a conference, and so none of our ministry is here, so we can just have a good party.
They're all here.
No, we're all ministers here.
Yes.
Ministers of the gospel. Let's see, is there anything else that I have? Colin Martin, I don't know if you all have heard about the fall that he has had, but Janelle Horst has an announcement about that, which she can come and do now. Oh, you take big steps.
Oh, sorry. I'm supposed to go over there.
Sorry.
Good morning. So before I get into what Janelle Martin sent me an email that I'll read to you, but I did want to just Harlan and I, we wanted to let you know that so God has been leading us through this whole process with Metzler and Alive, and I'm part of the church council at Metzler, and through this, like, yeah, honestly, from my thing from the beginning, this was a big yes to me, like that we're going to be doing something together, whatever God wants to do. And, but for our part, we do have commitments at Metzler, Sunday school, and worship team, and prayer team. And so we do have commitments there that God has not called us away from, and we want to be a part of there, and we also feel called here. So whatever God wants to do here. So when we don't need to be at Metzler for something, we plan on being here. So just wanted to let you all know that as well. And you can let us know if that's okay.
It's okay.
So from Kevin and Janelle Martin. Some of you know last week on Saturday afternoon, so I'll read, this is from her perspective, I'll read it from her perspective. Our son Colin was hiking with the youth group at Boxcar Rocks. He lost his balance on a rock ledge and fell over 20 feet. It appears that he landed on his right side or pelvis and right leg and eventually slid into a rock crevice. A friend saw it happen and called for help immediately. An EMT was on site shortly, and search and rescue and firemen worked about 1.5 hours to get him out to the ambulance that transported him to the helicopter, where he was airlifted to HMC, and we met them there. The EMT was certain that Colin had a compound femur fracture and was concerned for his head, spine, and internal injuries. Colin was in and out of consciousness and had excruciating pain in his leg. At the initial assessment in the trauma bay, the doctor looked at the wound in his leg and said it was very superficial. The muscle and fascia covering it were completely intact. CT scan showed that his femur was not broken. He had no head or brain injury, no back or neck injury, and no internal injuries. He has several airline fractures in his pelvis, a laceration on his forehead, and a laceration on his leg. He had surgery Saturday night to clean out the leg wound and suture it closed. Amazingly, he was discharged home 24 hours after the accident occurred. It is so clear to us that God was protecting Colin, and honestly, from other people speaking about it as well, that God was healing him as this was going on. But it was so clear to us that God was protecting Colin, providing for everyone in the situation. Here she says, hearing Colin all along, and we give God all the praise for these miracles. We also want to express our gratitude and appreciation for everyone who prayed and interceded for Colin, the youth group, and our family. But most of all, we desire to give God all the honor and glory and thanks for this miraculous healing and his divine intervention. We know that God and God alone could do this. He moved in more ways than we can imagine, which is evident in the testimonies of the youth advisors and people called in specific ways to pray and intercede. As we process this, we recognize this is not just our story. It is God's story, but it is also your story. We felt led to hold a night of worship and celebration to give thanks to God for this miracle. Please join us for a night of worship, sharing and hearing testimonies of God's power and work, not just in this event, but in your lives. Come prepared to share how you've seen God moving. Let's celebrate our awesome God and exalt his name. And if you're in the middle of the hard and difficult right now, come to be encouraged and praise God in the storm, knowing that he is working in your situation and his power to heal, redeem, and deliver is beyond your imagination. So you're invited to join in this night of worship and celebration next Sunday, May 1st, 7 o'clock p.m. here at Alive. And there will be worship songs, old and new, both hymns and contemporary songs. And we would love to have multiple generations of people coming together, united in praising God.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Janelle. With us this morning, since none of our pastors are here, we have Josh Rivera, who is going to be bringing our message this morning. And he also brought with him, as far as leading our worship, Billy and Lauren Stoy. Now, I'm going to let them share a bit later when they're going to be leading the worship. But before they start that, they're going to say a little bit about themselves, and so will Josh. But the reason they're up here right now is because Josh has a bad knee, and it's harder for him to get around. So that's why he's sitting here. So we have a memory verse that we are working on for the month, and Holly brought that up, I believe. Yes. So if you'd rise, and we'll do the site first, and then we'll do the verse, and then the site again. Okay. Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Hebrews 13:8. Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated. Is there anything I missed?
So far, I think we're okay.
Okay. Jean will bring the meditation.
I think it would be good if we all would just take a deep breath and say, Lord Jesus, you are the same forever and ever, and that won't ever change. I find comfort in that. I find reassurance in that. And I don't know how many of you have watched the series The Chosen, one of my favorites. And I think it's at the end of season one. There's a scene. The disciples are walking through a field with Jesus, and they're talking among themselves, and they're saying something like, well, Jesus, since you've been with us, things are different. You look at people differently. You look at life differently. You treat traditions differently. And they're making these comments, and Jesus just smiles, and he says, do you know what he says? Those of you who have seen it, get used to different.
Yeah.
Yes. And so this morning, we're going to get used to different. Things are a little bit aside from maybe the ordinary, but it's okay. God sent Jesus so things would be different for us. Now, in October 2018, Jerry and a carload of us went to Bethlehem Community Fellowship for an event called Spreading the Flame. It was an all-day event, great food, great fellowship. And I took my notebook, and I have about 5 or 6 pages in here of notes that I took when I was there, and they're still just as powerful today. I was reading through this when I knew you folks were coming, and I have lines of comments that Joshua made, and then later your wife, Raquel. So for my call to worship, for our focus, I'm going to use a particular comment, Josh, that you made, and then one of Raquel's. I didn't ask your permission, but I told you I was going to do this, and you said it's from the Holy Spirit, so it's okay. All right. Josh, one of the things you said about your church fellowship at that time was your goal was to establish a kingdom culture. And you got that emphasis or that focus from a verse that uses the word devoted. Do you know where I'm going with this? Do you remember? Okay, good. I'm going to read you the verse. It's from Acts chapter 2, verse 42. It's under the heading, the fellowship of the believers. They devoted themselves, they meaning the believers, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. There's 4 things that are listed here. The first is they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, which would be the teachings of Jesus. They devoted themselves to the fellowship or the community of believers. They devoted themselves to the breaking of bread or sharing meals together. And they devoted themselves to prayer. And Josh, you took those 4 different components and kind of, you did enlarge on them, explaining how that was affecting the growth of your church family. And that's still just as powerful today. What do we devote ourselves to? Where are my affections? And then Raquel talked quite a bit about mentoring and the importance that she had found mentoring to be in your church family. And she said that God mentors us through the Holy Spirit who lives in us. Did you ever think about yourself being mentored by God? Mm-hmm. And then we mentor others through the Holy Spirit and from the Holy Spirit, and that gives us a holy perspective on our mentoring. And I want to read just 2 more verses that tell us that we can do this, because I've heard too many times, I can't mentor, I don't know how to do that, I don't know what to say. And I think that comes from the human part of us. But in Colossians chapter 1, verse 19 says, God was pleased, and right there that makes me feel good, God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Jesus. Go over to the next chapter. It says, for in Jesus, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And you and I have been given fullness in Jesus. So that potential there for mentoring is huge if we remember the fullness that we have in Jesus through the Holy Spirit. Thanks for helping me out this morning, Josh. From my notes that I took those years ago, Jerry, would you please pray a blessing on the rest of our morning?
I will. Let us pray. Father, we come before you, thanking you that your Spirit is in this place. We thank you for your goodness, that you have blessed us with your Son to give us a plan, to give us salvation, Lord. We thank you for that plan of salvation that you had planned on even before the foundation of the world. Lord, we thank you that you have given your life for us, that because of you, we have been redeemed. Thank you for this service this morning. I pray for Josh as he brings to us what you would have us to hear. And I thank you for Billy and Lauren that will lead us in worship. And Lord, that as we lift up our voices in praise, that you would receive it to yourself, that you may be blessed and we may be blessed. Lord, I thank you for the monies that we receive this morning, that it may be used for your honor and glory. Lord, I pray for those who are in missions. I pray for Andrea, who's in YWAM in Montana, and for Austin, who is in YWAM in Lancaster, for Daniel and Marlene, who are in Uruguay, and also for Zach and Stevie with Haiti, Lord. We just ask your blessing upon them and thank you for their willingness to go and spread your word. Lord, we also pray for Colin, and we thank you for saving his life. Thank you for the healing that he is receiving. We also pray for the nations that are at war with each other, and we pray that there may be peace, Lord. We pray for our government that our government might seek you for wisdom in how to deal with these things, Lord. But most of all, we just pray for peace in this war that we have. We give you thanks and thank you again that you are our God and we are your people. Mm-hmm. And we praise your name. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Billy and Lauren, go ahead. Right. And after worship, Josh, if you just follow, and thank you.
Good morning, church.
Good morning. Yes.
Yeah, please stand. I can't stand today, so I'm sitting here with you, but we're honored to be here with you today. And again, my name is Billy. This is my wife, Lauren, and we come from Bethlehem Community Fellowship along with Pastor Josh, and we're blessed to be here today. And yeah, I really don't want to spend too much time talking. I think one thing I'll just say is that we had a conversation with Ken earlier this week in preparation for coming, and he asked us if we had songs prepared. And we said, you know, it's funny, we had a couple of songs prepared that we wanted to do. And as we were practicing and praying over them, it seemed like Holy Spirit had something else in mind. So he totally changed up all the songs for this morning, as he often does, because again, we have to get used to different. So I am trusting and believing that first and foremost, he is going to be pleased and glorified in the midst of our worship today. Yeah. And I also believe that he's going to minister to some of the hearts and minds in this room as well. So let's take a moment, posture our hearts towards the Lord. Mm-hmm. And we were told that you guys often open with a hymn. So we're going to do that for you as well. It might be a slightly different rendition than you're used to, but please join us in song.
How great thou art,
how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. And when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou
tell him again how great he is. So good, God. Jesus. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Thank you.
of a beautiful Father. And I will breathe deep and know that He is good. He's a love like no other.
His love is so good, church.
And I will lean back in the loving arms of a beautiful Father. And I will breathe deep and know that He is good. He's a love like no other. And I will lean back in the loving arms of a beautiful Father.
We have a good, good Father, church.
And I will breathe deep, know that He is good. He's a love like no other.
Thank you for your love, Father. Take a minute and just thank God for His goodness, for His love for us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your goodness and your grace and your mercy, God. Thank you for your unfailing love. Thank you for your faithfulness, Father. If anyone here feels like they struggle viewing God as Father, as a good Father, then I just want to ask you to take a minute and just receive this blessing over you. We're going to sing it over you right now.
Lean back in the loving arms of a beautiful Father. He loves you, He loves you. Breathe deep, know that He is good. He's a love like no other.
One more time, church.
Lean back in the loving arms of a beautiful Father. He loves you, He loves you. Breathe deep, know that He's good. He's a love like no other.
Those of you that do know that love of God, that perfect fatherly love that He pours out for us, that He showed in the sacrifice of His Son, this song is a great opportunity to just pour that love back out on Him, tell Him how much you love Him.
walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. And when you walk into the room, every heart starts burning. And nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you.
Church.
We love you,
and
we'll never stop. Can't live without you, Jesus. We love you,
and we can't get enough.
All this is for you, Jesus. We want you. Come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you.
Give him permission, church.
Come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. Want you.
One more time.
Come and consume, God, all we are. We give you permission. Our hearts are yours. We want you. We want you.
Jesus.
changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. And when you walk into the room, every heart starts burning. And nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you.
Thank you, Jesus, that when you walk into the room, nothing remains the same. Thank you, Jesus, that just when a light is turned on, darkness has no choice but to leave. Just like when heat is turned on, cold has no choice but to dissipate. When you walk into the room, life enters the room, so death has to leave. When you walk into the room, sickness has to flee. When you walk into the room, doubts disappear. And thank you that this isn't just a matter of like, maybe that's the case, but you are who you say you are, Jesus. You are who you say you are, Yahweh. You are who you say you are, Holy Spirit. And so right now, I thank you for your presence that is in this room. And I pray, just like Elisha prayed, that you would open eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to receive the invitation. Because you are here, Lord. Your presence is here in this place. Open eyes, open ears, soften hearts right now in greater measure than ever before. And let your presence be known. Let your pleasure be known in this place. Church, I invite you just to start praising the Lord in your own words. I mean, that might be weird for you guys, but just begin to thank him for his presence. Thank him that once we were all lost and now we're saved. We all were wandering and not knowing the way, and now we know. We have hope. We have a future. There's destiny. There's plans for us. That's not something we had before Jesus. And so I invite you, like Psalm 100 says, to enter into his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. Would you do that with me, church? Let's begin thanking him, opening our mouths and confessing our thanksgiving before him. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. I invite you to do it loud and proud, church. Thank you, Jesus. If you've been saved by Jesus, there's something to be grateful for. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence, for the cross, Jesus. Oh, thank you for the cross. Thank you for your broken body. Thank you for your blood poured out in the new covenant. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We give you honor. We give you glory. We give you praise. Oh, bright and morning star, faithful and true, Prince of Peace, mighty God, wonderful counselor, rock of ages, thank you. Thank you. Thank you that you are indeed the same yesterday, today, and forever. Thank you that your faithfulness has not changed. Thank you that you remain steadfast. Thank you that you are still on your throne. Thank you that this is your house. All glory. All honor, all power belong to you forever and ever, Jesus. Have your way in this place, Holy Spirit. Have your way. And we pray this in the mighty, in the matchless and in the undefeated name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thanks, Bill and Lauren. Appreciate you guys. Man, it's good to be here with you guys. When Bishop Jim asked Raquel and I to come, we were super excited. Unfortunately, my wife Raquel couldn't be here with us. Our son Ezra last night, he had a fever and it didn't break overnight. And my youngest son Judah, he has a molar coming in. And anyone have kids? Anyone remember what teething is like? There's a lot of other symptoms that happen with teething sometimes. So it's a little messy, and so she's home holding down the fort. So thank you. She's watching online. So can we all just say hello, Pastor Raquel, online? Hi, Pastor Raquel. Hi, Ezra. Hi, Judah. Miss you guys. So I'm Joshua, and along with my wife, Raquel, we pastor at Bethlehem Community Fellowship, where now Bishop Jim used to pastor. Bishop Jim is still our spiritual father. We're really excited to be here for a number of reasons. One is you guys have a beautiful church. Naturally, it's gorgeous. It's really nice in here. But also, when I walked in, there is such a peace in this place. And, like, it's a freshness and a refreshing. And maybe some of y'all don't feel like that, but I'm telling you, as someone who's not been here, you come in and you can sense that. Would you guys agree? And so you have such a beautiful church, and I know God is doing really great things here because we get to talk to Bishop Jim, and Bishop Jim real talks with us. So even if he's telling you really nice things, he's telling us the real things. And he has really great things to say about what's happening here at Alive and with Metzler. Can we just recognize the miracle that's happening? You know, what's happening here doesn't happen. I guess that's right, because when he walks into the room, everything changes. I don't know why I feel more excited about what's happening here than I feel like you guys are excited in this moment, but maybe I'm a little used to our congregation back at home. I need to be spoken to. If not, I will call out and ask questions, and it'll be awkward for everyone. But I am just so blown away at what God is doing in this place. And it's funny, as we were driving up, Holy Spirit was speaking all throughout the week as we were preparing, Raquel and I and Billy and Lauren, for today. Holy Spirit was speaking a bunch of different, at first it felt like disconnected themes. And then today, Gene, as you were speaking, and Jerry, as you were praying, you just hit on everything that Holy Spirit had been speaking to us. And so I'm just even more excited because Holy Spirit has a plan. He's leading, and we just get to be a part of it. That's good news, right? I'm telling you, y'all don't want me in charge. Be really happy that Holy Spirit is leading the way. Jim said that we should share a little bit of our background. And I love sharing testimonies. And so I'm just going to talk a little bit about myself and Raquel. We both grew up in the church. Raquel is a pastor's daughter. So her experience growing up in the church is very different from my experience growing up in the church. I thank God. I think it's miraculous that she's still serving God and pastoring now, after everything pastors' kids usually go through. I won't tell her story. You'll have to have us back to hear her side. And if the kids get sick, I promise I'll stay home next time with them. But I grew up in the faith. My parents are, mighty men and women of God. They got saved in a time where God was just moving mightily in New York City. So they were introduced into the kingdom and into the miraculous right away, which is, it's really great because we're Puerto Rican, and our background in Puerto Rico, naturalism really isn't a thing. You're very aware of demons and spirits, and so coming into the faith, it was good that my family was introduced to a powerful God, right? A Holy Spirit that defeated the devil at every turn. And so I grew up in that, seeing God move mightily. And I grew up with great parents, especially a father. I know there's a lot of father wounds in the world and in the church, but man, when I tell you I had a great dad, my dad was fantastic. We grew up pretty poor, and my dad was always working 2 to 3 jobs just to support us and make sure we had enough to eat. It's funny, you think back, some of my favorite dinners when I was a kid was when we had white rice and eggs. I was like, yes, it's eggs and rice day. or like frozen French fries and eggs. When you're like six, you're like, yes, there's no veggies on the plate. But you look back, you're like, wow, those are the two least expensive things that you can get from a grocery store. But I wasn't, I haven't been marked by poverty in that way. I didn't, as a kid, you don't recognize those things as poverty, especially because my dad worked so hard. But always in the midst of working two to three jobs at a time, I don't know when he slept, he still coached my little league. He still taught me how to shave. He still taught me how to ride a bike, taught me how to throw a baseball, a football, catch baseballs, footballs, taught me how to change my oil, rotate my tires. And now that I'm a father, I am even more blown away at how great my dad was. And he's still around, he's still active. Like, I excelled, because my dad's in his 70s. And for a lot of people, that's like grandparent age. I'm one of six. My parents didn't have Netflix or anything to distract them. There was just, I feel like the Mennonites can relate. And so he's old school. And even being old school, he's a very affectionate man, but he was big on like excellence. And you work and you do it right. And if you're gonna commit to something, you do it all the way. So I always had to like make sure I was starting on every baseball team. But he did it in such a way that I never felt like burdened, like I was gonna let him down. And I say that because I know that that's not everyone's earthly experience with their father. But mine was excellent. And I think because of that, I've always been able to relate to Father God and see Father God as just this loving man of excellence. But he's doing whatever it takes to support me, to make sure that I'm connected, to make sure that I'm set up for success. And as we were coming in, the theme of Father, the Father kept coming up. And I was asking the Holy Spirit this morning, I was like, why? And he said, because this is my house. Alive, you are the Father's house. You know, one of the Father's house, right? We're all the church. But I believe I'm giving you a prophetic word right now. Whether you receive it as that, you know, that's up to you. Please test it. Talk to Bishop Jim. Make sure I'm not crazy. I believe the Lord said that this is his house. This is the Father's house. I'm not going to preach about that. That means it's a house of prayer. It means that he's the host. It means that we do what Papa says. He has his way in this house. But that means he has marked this house. He has chosen this house. Apart from your giftings, apart from your abilities, apart from your plans, because y'all might not like what he wants to do with his church, he's going to have his way. And I hope that's encouraging, because I honestly see success for you guys. I don't see it. I sense just success for you guys. And I can't wait. I hope I get to come back every once in a while to see how y'all are doing. But I believe God's going to do amazing things, because this is his house. And in his house, he's in the Father's house, he's going to raise up spiritual fathers and mothers who will mentor. And you will have the fullness, right? Because in his house, he's fully there. And the title of the message today is The Fullness of God. I don't know if you guys knew that, but as you're praying, even pulling those verses from Colossians, I'm like, great, I don't have to preach. I can just talk about whatever I want. But the title of today's message is the Fullness of God. Let me stop. I'm going to jump around a lot. I apologize. Actually, I don't apologize. I'm here visiting. Y'all are stuck with me. So I grew up in the faith, and in eighth grade, my dad was bit by a rabid raccoon. And he had to get the rabies shots, and through like, it was like a one in a million chance, he developed brain tumors as a result of the rabies shots. And his pituitary was crushed by one of these brain tumors, and he developed meningitis. And there was a good, like, maybe 5-6 years when my father was in the hospital having brain surgery after brain surgery. It was a really difficult time to be fatherless. You know, eighth grade into college. So that time in my life was a little shaky, to say the least. Let's say I was not walking with the Lord during that time. Not fully. And it was just super difficult. But God was really kind to me, as he's always provided spiritual fathers in my life. My wife's father, I went to their church, and he fathered me. As you guys know, Bishop Jim was a huge influence in my life, and he still is Raquel and I's spiritual father. But during that time, it was very shaky, and coming out of it, it's a long story, so I'm not going to get into it. But the doctors told us that 100% my father was not going to be able to see, smell, or hear when he was done with these strings of surgery, that he would have to be on medication that was going to cause cancer. It eventually did, resulting in his prostate being removed. But my dad came out of that very difficult season of life with 20/20 vision, perfect hearing, and sight, or smell, his sense of smell. And the doctors couldn't figure out how the meningitis was miraculously healed. It was bacterial meningitis. Miraculously healed during that time. And he came out, and now my dad still exercises regularly. He was just, I coach my son's T-ball. And so he was just at, this Saturday was opening day, he was just at the game buying, of course, sugary ice cream cones for my kids. Because, you know, that's what you do when you're a granddad. But I saw God move so mightily through that. And that really stuck with me. And in November of 2012, I'm jumping because I want to get to the word for, that I believe Holy Spirit gave me for you guys. I met Holy Spirit for the first time. I always joke and say that I got saved in waves, right? When I was in high school, one of the people who mentored me was a youth pastor. And he would continually invite me to, like, leadership conferences for, like, youth. And I was like, Pastor Mike, I don't like you. I'm never going to be a leader in the church. Ironic. Billy was there during that time in my life. And he would invite me, and when I went to this one Awaken the Dawn Leadership Conference, I met God. Like, I had no doubt I met God. There was a prophet, which, like, I made me roll my eyes at that time whenever I heard something like that. And his name was Pat Bob. And when you're in high school, that's just like, there's no grace. But he began giving words of knowledge. And I was like, he's faking it. These people saw a group thing. But then he started talking about me, but the room didn't know he was talking about me, but I knew he was talking about me, and it made me very, very uncomfortable. And I mean, things that there's no way he would have been able to know. So I met God, I was like, okay, God, you're real. I got to figure out what that means. And I began reading my Bible and trying to do good things, and there was just, I say got saved in waves, because like, all right, God, you're real, I got to do something about it. Then later on in life, I understood the gospel, because you can hear the gospel for a very long time. But I understood the gospel. I was like, okay, it's not about what I can do. It's what Jesus did for me, and now I get to respond to that for the rest of my life. But in November 2012, I met Holy Spirit, and my life was forever changed. I was never the same after November 2012. And Holy Spirit took a hold of my life and began inviting me to do things that made no sense. And that were pretty wild, and if he didn't show up miraculously, would leave behind really big messes. But I said yes to him, and I obeyed him, and he led me through everything. One of the things that he told me was that Raquel was going to be my wife. So Raquel and I went to high school together, and we never dated, we were just friends. But in college, I was seeking, I was fasting for 3 days, and the Lord said, Raquel's going to be your wife. And I was like, awesome. Like, dating is hard. And just, it could be messy. It's just not fun. Maybe some of y'all don't remember because you have to, like, date to see if you want to marry someone. It's hard. It's messy. It's even harder nowadays. Pray for the kids. And I went up to her super excited. I was like, babe, guess what? I didn't say babe, actually. I was like, Raquel, guess what? I'm going to save you so much time. Holy Spirit said you're going to be my wife. And I didn't grow up in church the way she grew up in church as the pastor's daughter. And, like, I forget exactly what she said, but she kind of rolled her eyes and gave me one of those get in line. And I was offended because I was kind of, like, you know, suave and smooth in high school. I was like, maybe you don't understand the gift of the Lord that stands before you right now. But I said, the Lord say, you are going to be my wife. You're welcome. For some reason, she didn't get it. I still don't understand, babe. The Lord hadn't opened your eyes yet, I guess. But it was like a year or so later, we started dating. And I was like, yes, we're going to be married. And the passage that the Lord gave me to confirm our marriage was out of Genesis 29:20. And it says, and Jacob labored 7 years for Rachel, but it felt as if only 7 days. And I was like, oh, fantastic. Yeah, because at that time I had known Raquel for 7 years. I was like, this ain't going to be like Leah. I'm not going to have to wait another 7 years to be married. This is great. A year and a half later, we broke up. I was like, oh, and it shook me. But fast forward through a lot of time, me learning how to hear the voice of the Lord, learning how to wait on the Lord, learning how to test a word, and growing in maturity, because, man, you need maturity. It's kind of scary that the Lord will gift you before he matures you. That's why community is important, but that's another message. Anyway, exactly 7 years later, to the date that he told me, Raquel and I were married. And it was, May 7th, 2016, we were married, exactly 7 years to the date. And it was beautiful because during that time, I had zero money. Say zero money, church. Oh, just my crew? Come on. Yeah, talk to me, guys. Say zero monies. I'm sorry. I'm going to be that guy. Zero monies. All right. I'm going to come speak with many of you after. I had no money, and I was like, how am I supposed to marry this? And again, my father's an old school kind of man. So you do not ask a woman to marry you unless you have the house that you will live in, the car that you will drive, and the bank account that says we can have children. I had none of those things. So me and my father had many conversations during that season of life. But during that time, Holy Spirit would speak to me and guide us to different places. And would you believe I had no money, but God provided money for a nice wedding ring. Diamond wedding band for free. I got married at a TLC wedding venue. I don't know if you guys, anyone watches TLC? It's a television network where there's lots of fancy weddings and other things. We got married at one of their venues for absolutely free. It was insured, paid for. We had a wedding and a honeymoon for nothing, including our wedding dress, my tux, the catering, the photographer. Everything was 100% free. We actually walked out of our wedding and honeymoon with a lot of money. I was like, ooh, God is good. And I share that because, man, Holy Spirit, he'll change your life if you let him. And after that, we live in a house that we wouldn't be able to afford, but God gave us over $20,000 in 2 weeks for free, not a loan that we had to pay back, so that we could buy the house that we live in right now. He has been a faithful provider, and it's carried over into the church too. When we let Holy Spirit have his way, he will make the impossible possible. Do you know how crazy the Great Commission was to give to 12 dudes? Well, actually, there was 11 at that time and like about 500 total. Go and make disciples of the nations. There was no internet. There was no cell phones. There were no planes. How are these 500 people going to reach the nations? It was impossible, but if Holy Spirit is the one doing it, nothing's impossible. And so we applied that to the church, and everything in the church said, Holy Spirit, okay, you have your way. What do you want to do? How do you want to do it? And let me tell you, especially for y'all planners, that's scary. That's real scary. My wife is a planner. I'm a fly-by-the-seat-of-my-pants kind of guy, so I love it. I thrive in those situations. My wife's trying not to have a panic attack. Let me tell you, if you're married and your wife or your spouse is having a panic attack, it affects everything. But we let Holy Spirit lead us moment by moment. And so we saw the church, and Jim taught us this really. During a time where millennials were leaving the church, they kept flocking into our church. And we had the spray and the flame. And it was like, what's the secret? Like, when we find out, we'll let you know. And you know what the secret is? Let Holy Spirit lead his church. Let Holy Spirit lead your church. Let Holy Spirit lead your home. You know, he didn't purchase his church for a price. He purchased you for a price. Jesus purchased you. That means you give up your way of life. You got to be like Moses in Exodus 33:13, who says, if I have found favor, grace in your sight, show me your ways that I may know you and find favor. And remember that we are your people. We have to know the ways of God, right? And he communicates that to us through the Holy Spirit and through his word. And so the message I have today is called the fullness of God, because it is what God wants you to walk in, the fullness of God, right? The fullness of God dwelled bodily in Jesus Christ. Paul writes in Romans that if the Lord gave up his son for us, how much more will he give us all things with his son? That includes the fullness of God. He wants you to walk in the fullness as individuals and as a church body. That's good news, right? Anybody want that? If you want that, say amen. Okay, we're warming up. Y'all are warming up to me. The fullness of God. So if you have your Bibles with you, I'm reading from the New King James. I don't know what we'll have. It might be NIV up there. We'll see. I forgive you because the New King James Version is like the inspired version. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Ephesians chapter 3. And I'm going to start at verse 14, and I'm going to read to verse 19. Say amen when you're there. Never mind, it's up there. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen. That was the only perfect part of this sermon, y'all. The word of God. The fullness of God. What do we mean when we say the fullness of God? Right? I believe we interpret scripture with scripture. So if you flip over to the next chapter, in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13, it talks about the fullness of God, right? That he wants to mature the church till we all come to the unity of the faith of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. You know, I can hear my wife yelling at me. I forgot to mention that if you want the sermon notes, we always put them up on our website. And so if you have a phone or a tablet, you can go to werebcf.com/sermons. Hit sermon notes and just go down to the fullness of God. I did it, babe. Till we all come, so the fullness of God is coming to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. What does the fullness of God look like? Jesus Christ. What are we called to look like? Jesus Christ. Jesus is the model. Say that with me. Jesus is my model. When you're thinking church ministry, who's your model? In parenting, who's your model? In mentoring, who's your model? In operating in the gifts of the Spirit, who's your model? In overcoming sin, temptation, and suffering, who's your model? He is the model. We are to look like him. We are called to be one with Jesus. Jesus prays in John chapter 17, verses 20 and 21. He prays for his disciples, for all who will believe, saying, through their word, that they may be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. Jesus wants us to be one with him. Not only is he our model, but we are to be one. This language is similar to marriage, right? A man and a wife come together as one. That takes time, but you'll be surprised what happens. I am a simple man at heart. I'm a minimalist. All of my apartments, guess how many pictures I had on the wall? Zero. You know what I slept on? As a grown man, a futon mattress on the floor. I had never purchased a bedroom set. Most of my, like, wardrobes and stuff came from either the thrift store or dumpster diving. And it's not because I couldn't afford it. I was just like, why spend the money there? That just was not me. And then I married Raquel, and she is not that way. She's like, we need pictures on the wall. But, like, why? So people know it's our home. We know it's our home. Why do they need to know that it's our home? Not only that, she would buy things for the home that I felt were so frivolous and foolish. Y'all, did you know there's little scented pine cones for the fall that smell like cinnamon? Like you put them in a bowl on the table and supposedly you smell cinnamon throughout the house? I thought that was such a waste of money. Throw pillows? Why are they called throw? I've never seen anyone just throw those pillows. Duvets and duvet covers. For a long time, I didn't know what the difference between a duvet and a bidet was. But after we were married for a little bit, I remember coming home after work and opening the front door, especially after like long days, and all of a sudden my house smells like apples, cinnamon, and I would sit down on the actual comfy chair, and I would look and I would see pictures of my family on the wall. was like, oh, this is so nice. It was so wonderful. And then the fall would come around, but like, baby, did we get those little scented pine cones yet? Right? We sit down and watch something, and she likes watching the British baking show. And I would like, oh, let's do it. All right. And then, you know, a couple months later, I'm like, that pie has a soggy bottom, babe. I know it. Just wait. Paul's going to rip them a new one. Right? All of a sudden, we start becoming one, meaning the things that she likes, I start to like. The things that I prioritize, she begins to prioritize. Through the intimacy of relationship every day, day in and day out, we begin to become one. Our priorities are shared. Our finances are shared. She is my number one partner. She is my number one earthly partner, my number one earthly pursuit. We share all things together. That's the heart of the Father for you and Jesus, also for you and Father God, and for you and Holy Spirit. You are, day in and day out, to be growing in intimacy with one another, right? We call that at our church the secret place. Anyone heard that language before? Right? It comes from Psalm 91, Matthew chapter 6, right? Pray to your Father who is in the secret place. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty, right? So when we have time with God, we call it secret place time. That's where we become one. That's date night. Maybe that language is uncomfortable, but the Bible uses a lot of uncomfortable language to describe our relationship with Father God, right? Jesus and his church, that's us and him, are likened to a husband and a wife, and husbands are called to love their wives the way Jesus loves his church, right? So even in marriage, Jesus is our model. Jesus is our model. We are called to be one with him, and this was always the plan. In Genesis chapter 1, when God decides and to create mankind, he says, let us make man in whose image? Our image, in our likeness. He didn't only make Adam and Eve to look like him, but to function like him. As he said, be fruitful, multiply, have dominion, and subdue the earth. Walk in greatest authority upon the earth. The same way God exhibited authority by speaking and creating everything, he gave Adam similar authority. He said, speak and name the animals. This is why when mankind fell away from the Lord in Genesis chapter 11 and they were scattered, what was the evidence of that? Their languages were confused. Right? We were created to be like God, to function in partnership with God. This was always the plan. And so God wants us to walk in this fullness, in this partnership, as individuals and as a body and as a church. And here in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 16 to 19, I believe Paul shows us exactly how to walk in that fullness. In verse 16, Paul prays that the Father would grant us, according to the riches of his glory, first to be strengthened. So the first thing, right, if you're taking notes, point number one, this is, how do we access the fullness of God? Point number one, you receive his gift. He prays that the Father would grant you. You know what a grant is? It's a gift. You don't have to pay grants back, praise Jesus, if you went to college and got grants. You don't pay grants back. They're a gift. They cost someone something, but they don't cost you anything. And this is demonstrated, right, that he would grant you according to whose riches? His riches. You know what's great about that? It doesn't matter whether you can afford it or not. You don't got to pay for it. Someone else is paying for it. You know why scientists love grants? Because scientists are broke. They can't afford to fund their own research, so they need someone else to pay the cost and fund it for them, right? The first thing you need to do to walk in the fullness of God is receive this free gift. Now, the free gift comes with terms, right? Just like a research grant or a scholarship grant comes with terms. You got to study. You got to research, right? The terms of this free gift, the fullness of God, or one, Jesus is Lord and Savior of your life. Romans 10:9 says that if you confess, speak it with your mouth, that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that the Father resurrected him from the grave, you will be saved, right? The death and resurrection of God was the atoning sacrifice for all time, right? So you must receive God, Jesus specifically. I believe in the Trinity, and Jesus is God, Father God, and Holy Spirit. They're, you know, one in three persons, all right? But you have to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. And Lord means master. That means I live now for his pleasure. You got to speak that. You got to confess that. Jim used to say, if Jesus isn't Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. He's Lord of everything, and he has saved you from your sin. You have to accept him as that every day, every time you wake up. Sometimes I wake up and I forget that he's Lord. I'm like, I'm going to do what I want with my time and my money and my resources. The Holy Spirit's right there like, oh, that's right, he's Lord. The second term that I would argue, I don't have time to go into it all scripture, but the second term to this is you must accept Holy Spirit, and we say it like this in our church, as president and power source. He is your president and your power source. That means he decides what you do day in and day out. He decides what's acceptable, what's unacceptable. And he is your power source. Everything he calls you to do, you have to do it through him. Right? And this brings me to my second point. To walk in the fullness of God, you must be strengthened in your inner man by the might of his Spirit. You must be strengthened by Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit must be your president and your power source. Pull something out real quick. What's this? It's a credit debit card. It actually says business debit, right? It has my name on it, but it actually has Bethlehem Community Fellowship on it. This is the church card, right? So when I am out on official church business, this is my resource, right? This one has my name on it. This one's my debit card. You know what's really cool about this one? Doesn't matter how much I have on this one when I'm using this one. All right, I hope you're following, right? I can have a negative balance on this one, but when I am on mission for the church, that balance doesn't matter. I could be burnt out. I could be failing. I could feel like I have nothing to offer. But when Holy Spirit is your president and power source, that means you have been sanctioned to do something of him. He will supernaturally source you to do it. But it always takes a step of faith on your part. Go pray for that person. Let me lead here. No. Instead of making the most logical decision, I want everyone to stop, pray right now, and ask me what pleases me most. And I'm going to trust Holy Spirit and other people. And as that weirdo, because there's always a weird prayer person in the church, right? They have this vision. I'm going to trust that might be from God. Let's test it. Let's see. Does that violate scripture, right? When you allow Jesus, Holy Spirit, to be your president and power source, you will be so surprised how strong you will become in your inner man, right? And we call the inner man the heart, right? The Greek word cardia. It's the seat of your passions and your emotions, that inner person. At BCF, we define it as your thoughts, feelings, and desires. You will be strengthened in that area, your thoughts, feelings, and desires, empowered in that area, right? To walk in the fullness, you must be empowered by Holy Spirit. Must be empowered by Holy Spirit. That means if you are doing only the things that you can succeed in on your own, it's probably not the work of God. I'm going to say it again. The things that you put your hands to as a church, as people, if Holy Spirit doesn't have to show up to make it happen, it's probably not him calling you to do it. Look at every Bible example you can think of right now. Let that challenge you and start asking Holy Spirit, what are you calling me to do? Right? Because if you're not obeying his call, he's not president. And if you could do it without him, he's not your power source. I'm going to move on to the next point. So number two, he has to strengthen us in our inner man. So that number three could happen. We must allow Christ to dwell in our hearts through faith. I believe it's in this order intentionally. I know a lot of great churches that, man, they are rooted in the Word of God. And I mean, hey, amen. I'm a Bible geek. I love Strong's G2731, Ecclesia. I love hearing that. I love studying that. But without Holy Spirit, you'll become just like the Pharisees. You have a lot of Bible memorized, but you won't be living any of it. And when Holy Spirit does show up, when Jesus does show up, you won't be able to recognize him. So first, Holy Spirit must empower you within so that you can have Jesus rooted within your heart. I love John chapter 1. It describes Jesus as the Word. And I would say, I would argue that this means you have to have the Word rooted in your heart in faith. Listen, the Word of God is so important. I know everything I know about God because of this. I trust Holy Spirit's voice when I test it against this and I recognize, oh, that is you, Holy Spirit. Because Jesus told the disciples, I have many more things to say to you, but you cannot bear them. Therefore, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will lead you in all truth. He will take what is mine and declare it to you. So Holy Spirit will only ever confirm what is in the written Word of God. You must have the Word of God rooted in your heart by faith. By faith. This isn't an intellectual exercise, right? I just have to memorize. If I study the word enough, it'll get into my heart. That's not how it works. Ask the Pharisees. Ask the Sadducees. Ask the Essenes. They all missed Jesus, who was the word embodied, because they did not have the word rooted in their hearts by faith. And faith means informed trust. That I believe that as I am reading the word, it is reading me. As I read the word, it is transforming me, right? Romans 12 says, be transformed by the renewing of our mind. In Ephesians chapter 5, Paul writes to the church of Ephesus that Jesus presents us to himself perfect, blemish-free, spotless, without wrinkle, by the washing of the waters of the word. By faith, you must allow the word of God to take root in your life. That means during your Bible reading time, there's never a time where it was ineffective. If you want to hear the voice of God, read the word. If you want to hear the audible voice of God, read it out loud. In faith, informed trust, I know the nature of my God. I know his promises. The Bible says in Philippians that he is the one who works in us to both will and do his good pleasure. So I believe every time I open it and read it and it's rooting in me, it will produce fruit. Jesus mentions this in the parable of the sower in Matthew chapter 13. In fact, he says this parable is essential to understanding all the other parables. The seed he is sowing is the word of God. And the soil is our hearts. He wants his word to be rooted in our hearts. Number one, it's a free gift. Number two, to walk in the fullness, Holy Spirit must empower us. Number three, the Word of God must be rooted in us. And when it's rooted in us, we can produce fruit. That's how you get the fruit of the Spirit in your life. You meet with Jesus in the secret place. You read his word. You ask to see his face in this. And like 2 Corinthians 3:15 says, we gaze upon the face and we're transformed into its glory. You must have the word of God rooted in your heart. And you must allow the word to take root in us. And as it does, it will also root us in my fourth and final point here, in the love of God. That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of God which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. You know what I love about that word, comprehend? It actually means to lay hold of, to seize upon. Kind of makes sense in context, right? That you being rooted and grounded in love may be able to lay hold of, seize upon the width, the height, the width, the length, the depth, and the height. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. If you only know about the love of God and you don't experience the love of God, you'll never walk in his fullness. God's presence is to be experienced. It cannot only be an intellectual exercise. Yes, God loves me, because in 1 John it says that God is love. And in Romans it says that God loved me, so he gave his son. John 3:16, for God so loved. Yes, I understand. No, you must comprehend. You must get your hands on it. You have to know what it feels like to be loved by him. Anyone ever been like almost crippled by the love of God? A time in worship or in your time alone with the Lord, and you just begin to weep and weep and weep that he loves me so much that he would give himself for me? If you haven't, you should. And that's Paul's prayer for the church of Ephesus. And that's my prayer for you. I pray that you're so rocked by the love of God as you experience that food loses its taste. That you want nothing to do but just remain in the love of God. Why? Because you need to be rooted in it to walk in the fullness. Not only do you need to be rooted, you need to be rooted in love because love is what should move us. I love in the Bible where it says, Jesus had compassion, thus he healed their sick. Jesus moved with compassion, began to teach them and deliver them. Jesus moved with compassion, man. As pastors, we live a busy life. And a lot of people get to go home after church with their families. Like, we're usually stuck ministering to people, and we're usually really tired at the end of Sunday. And then there's always someone with that final need. And I can't lie, I'm not always moved by love. I'm not always moved by compassion. I'm like, what do you need? Mm-hmm. This totally could have waited. I'm going to go home. Anybody been there? Thank you for the two people telling the truth. Anybody been there? All right, we're going to have a conversation about lying. We all know what that's like. When you're in a rush, you're not being moved by compassion. Your family knows. When you're late somewhere, when you're rushing somewhere, you're prioritizing not love, not compassion, but your destination. Right? We cannot be moved by anything other than love. There's a story where Jesus sent his disciples out, and they're doing all these great things. He brings them aside. He's like, all right, let's go rest. We've been working a lot. And a great multitude follows him, and he had compassion on them. So he begins to teach them. It got late in the day. The disciples were like, all right, we're hungry. You're hungry. You need a nap. Send them away. He's like, no, give them something to eat. Right? And that being moved by compassion led to one of the greatest miracles. 5,000 men, not including women and children, were fed off of, I think, two fish, five loaves. I can't remember it right now, but y'all know the story, right? What a move of God. And it all began with Jesus being moved by compassion. You must experience the love of God to be moved by the love of God. You will never know God's heart for people until you know God's heart for you. And it has, church, please hear me. Please hear me. And don't just hear me, but like, yeah, I know. Hear me as if I'm talking about something that you could have deeper revelation of. You must experience the love of God. I know we don't want to be crazy charismatics. I mean, my wife and I come from that crazy Pentecostal background. There's a lot of weird things that happen. But you cannot come into contact with the most powerful thing in creation and not experience something new, not experience something messy. Look, do you want growth here? Church, do you want growth here? Do you want to see God move here? Do you want to see God move in this place? There's a proverb that says, where there are no oxen, the troughs are clean, but much increase comes by the strength of the ox. Meaning, life is messy. And if you don't want a mess, that means your life has to be full of dead things, or things at least with no life. Because life is messy. I got kids. They're alive. They are supernaturally messy. Pets are alive. Messy. Marriages that are alive, they're messy. Ooh, I think that's a word for someone. If your marriage ain't messy, is it alive? I'm not talking about chaotic. I'm saying messy. There has to be life. And I know God is calling you, church, to walk in his fullness. In his fullness. But that means messy. That means all 21 of the gifts of the Spirit. Even the weird ones. That means surrendering to Holy Spirit as president and power source. That means choosing to be united so that God commands blessing on your unity instead of being right. God wants you to walk in his his fullness. And to do so, you have to understand it is a free gift. Listen, the minute you try to start earning it, the Lord's going to back off. Do you hear me? The minute you try to start earning it, working for it, the Lord's going to back off. It's his free gift. He paid for it. Receive it. And let that humble you. That what God does here is not going to be tied to anyone's anointing, anyone's gifting, anyone's competency, anyone's level of excellence. It's his free gift. Take it. You couldn't have afforded it anyway, and that's good news. Number two, you have to be empowered by his spirit. And that might mean you become the church where people lay on their face. Y'all might become banner churches. You might become the church where you have to talk to someone because they just keep jumping up and speaking in tongues because they can't help themselves. And you're going to have to wrestle with, okay, Lord, what does Scripture really say about this? Do we shut this down, or do we start asking if someone has interpretation? You might have to get used to not having such a rigid schedule. Holy Spirit has to empower you, though. You will never do the work that God has for you if it's not Holy Spirit empowering you, if it's not Holy Spirit calling the shots. When you gather on Sundays, and let me say this, everyone plays a part. Do you know why no one has all 21 gifts? Because it's a body. My hand can't just decide tomorrow morning it's going to be a foot. It'd be really weird walking around. Y'all might enjoy seeing me try to walk like that, but a hand is a hand. My hands need my feet. My feet need my legs. My legs need my eyes. My eyes need my ears. All of you play a part. The time for sitting in the pews and just spectating, it's over. Because the Lord said this is his house, and so he's going to have it walk in the fullness. That means everyone comes to this house with something for him. You don't come to this house waiting for something from him. This is great, because when you preach in the church, you could be like messy and then just leave it a mess. But like, Jim, have fun. You all have something to bring for the Lord. And it might not happen up here. For 99% of you, it's not going to happen up here. Nonetheless, you have something equally valuable and important and necessary to bring to the Lord here. And it's always going to be your praise. He wants you to be empowered. Okay, sorry. I always get stuck there. It's one of my favorite topics. He wants the word rooted in your hearts. Man, I love the word of God. I study. One of the disciplines I practice the most and I connect with God with the most is solitude and study. I would say meditation is third. But it has to be rooted in your hearts by faith. I'm not saying that everyone has to become a student of the word, although I'd make an argument for it. I'm saying everyone needs to become a lover of the word. That means you prioritize it every day. Heck, y'all should be in the secret place at least once a day. Every day connecting with God. Word must be rooted. And number three, you must be rooted in God's love. For you and his love for people, including the ones outside of this church. But sometimes it's hard to love the people in the church. You must be rooted in his love. You must be experiencing his love. If not, you're not walking in the fullness of God. If not, you're not walking in the transformative power of God. And let me tell you what, I got a strong sense that the Lord said, this is my house. In terms of it's not up for negotiation. It's mine. So you have an opportunity, I believe, to get on board with what God wants to do. Or else it's going to be real uncomfy. God wants you to walk in his fullness. He wants to release his fullness to you. If we as Christians receive God's gift, if we're empowered by Holy Spirit, rooted in the word of God, moved by his love for us and for others, we will step into the fullness of God. And that's maturity. Ephesians 4:13 says, till we all come to the unity of faith, the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of fullness of Christ. That word perfect, it means it's more, when we hear perfect, we think of like without problems, but the actual Greek word means more mature, it's maturation. If you want to be mature, you need to be walking in the fullness of God. If you consider yourself a mature Christian, ask yourself, do I walk in this fullness? God has great things for you, and I'm so excited. I want to pray for you, I think Billy hobbled off, so I'm not going to call him back up. It'll take him a while anyway. But as I pray for you, I want to encourage you guys to really think. And again, you could listen. I hope you listened today, because you could always go to the notes to figure out if you disagree with me later. But I hope you hear me today that God wants you to walk in his fullness. That means the way Jesus lived, that's available to you. The way he overcame suffering and sin. Hebrews 2 says he doesn't give aid to angels. He gives aid to the sons of Abraham, which is it's a biblical term of saying those who are saved. He gives aid to those who are saved because suffering and being tempted at all points, he's able to help us when we suffer and are tempted. All of heaven's resources are at your back if you would put your hand to his plow and build his kingdom. And in this church, if you build his house, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the thoughts of man, the great things that God has planned for you. God wants to do great things at Alive Church. And man, you will be alive. And if you're alive, it's going to be messy. That's not even a prophetic word. That's just like, if you want crops to grow, you're going to have to get rained on. You will be alive. I feel so confidently of that. So would you stand and pray with me? Holy Spirit, we thank you so much for this church, for the Father's house here at Alive. We thank you, Lord, that you are doing great things, that already you are doing impossible things, things that have never been seen before. And I thank you that it's just the beginning. I thank you that we are not going to despise humble beginnings here. But like a little yeast is placed into bread until the whole thing is leavened, so your kingdom seed has been sown here. And it will grow, and it will grow, and it will become bigger than all of the trees. All of the bushes and the birds of the air will come rest in its branches, and the animals of the field will come rest in its shade. I thank you, Father, for your word, and I ask that you would confirm your word to your people. Lord, forgive anything that was of me. I pray that only your rhema word would have been deposited and sown into the hearts and minds of those that are hearing my voice today. I thank you for Alive Church. I proclaim blessing over Alive Church. I proclaim that it is the first, not the last. It is the head, not the tail. It is above, not beneath. That this is a church full of men and women who are more than conquerors. It is full of spiritual fathers and spiritual mothers who will raise up spiritual children. It is full of world changers in the mighty name of Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that you would make them risk takers in the kingdom. That they would be just crazy enough to believe that if you said it, you'll do it. That they are crazy enough to believe that Jesus, you actually are Lord. That Holy Spirit, you actually are president and power source. And that no one could do as good a job leading your church than you. May we build your kingdom and may we be faithful to your ways. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Father God. We love you, Holy Spirit. And Jesus, in your mighty, matchless, and undefeated name, we pray. Amen. Live Church, thank you so much for having us. Turn it over to Gina and Jerry. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Pastor. Do you prefer to be called Josh or Joshua?
I answer to both.
Okay. Well, thank you for being here and the rest of you from Bethlehem. It was so refreshing to have you here and encouraging. Thank you so much. And you kept talking about this word fullness. I've been really captured with that word fullness. And in that word, I sense that when we can find the fullness of God through the Holy Spirit and the presence of Jesus, there's a rest there that comes in that fullness. So you had said that in order for us to know the ways of God, we need to walk in that fullness. And I had to think, there's a verse in Psalm 103 that I found years ago, and it was like light bulb time for me, but it says, he, meaning God, he made known his deeds, what he could do. He made known his deeds to the people of Israel. But God made known his ways, his character, or his fullness to Moses. And then in Colossians 1, it says, to pull this all together, our world is real that we live in. But it says that in Colossians chapter 2, reality is found in Jesus. You can go home and find that yourself, but reality, our reality, whether it's messy or not, is found in Jesus and in his fullness. Thank you for coming. Jerry, do you have a benediction for us?
I do have a benediction from Romans. Listen carefully. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace.
Thank you.